artificial intelligence has taken the corporate world by storm, with some 50% of CEOs worldwide integrating generative AI into their digital products and services. Now, tech giant IBM believes AI can improve decision making and help companies meet their sustainability goals.
So joining us today for some insight on adopting AI, we have Agnes Heftberger, the General Manager and Technology Leader of IBM ASEAN Australia, New Zealand, and Korea. Agnes, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
Not a lot of people probably know or remember that IBM is an OG in AI. You're telling me 10 years ago.
More than 10 years ago,
you were already doing, creating AI solutions for different companies around the world as part of your core product, right?
Absolutely, yeah. IBM is a hybrid cloud and AI company. And as you mentioned, more than 10 years ago, we launched our first AI products into the market. And we see, as you already mentioned, that adoption has been widespread, but it hasn't really kind of happened at scale. And with the emergence of generative AI and with the possibility to now be really, really fast in deploying AI model, what we expect and what we also hear from CEOs across the world is that that's going to happen a lot faster and a lot wider. What we call this is, in the past we saw kind of, you know, AI being added to things, to services, to workflows, to processes. We call it plus AI. Mm-hmm. Now we think, you know, generative AI is going to be at the core of what we do. We will reimagine services. We will reimagine products. We will reimagine processes, right? So it will be AI first, AI plus. And I think that's quite a tremendous shift that's happening and a great opportunity for companies and societies, really.
And you're seeing AI doing part of the decision making for companies as well. But before that, I first want to ask, part of our what we're going to be discussing is about the sustainability goals of companies. Yeah. I understand IBM and AI, but IBM, AI and sustainability goals, how did that happen?
We have the strong belief that technology is really key in solving some of our biggest problems as societies. And I mean, I think we can all argue climate change, generally the changes we see in our environments are some of the biggest challenges that we have. And it will probably need technologies like AI, maybe down the road quantum computing, to really tackle these challenges. We have a lot of data around, you know, the environment, what's going on around us, but to make sense of this vast amount of data, we need technologies like AI. Mm-hmm. So I really believe that down the road, in order to tackle what we have at our hands, we will have to tap into the power of technology, and that's what we at IBM stand for.
Was your CEO study this year, does it say that? Does it also say that CEOs now believe that, you know, AI, when you're more technologically advanced, you're able to create a sustainable pathway and therefore save the planet? Or is it, as I suspected, that people are still worrying whether if we do the sustainability path, we may reduce our profitability?
A very interesting question. So we do a CEO study, as you mentioned, every year already for decades, really. And we kind of see what's emerging on the minds of CEOs. We talk to 3,000 plus CEOs in 30 plus countries, right? So that's quite an interesting picture. Last year, we asked them about sustainability, and we could really see how it was rising on their agenda of most pressing issues that they get kind of confronted with from stakeholders, and also a first notion that data, AI, cloud could be ways of addressing it. What we saw this year, where we were diving a lot deeper in the decision-making procedures of CEOs and focus areas of CEOs, we see AI still featuring very high, productivity along with sustainability really coming up. And I think it does make sense. Often when we look at ways to make the processes of companies more productive, we will make them more sustainable, and the other way around. Mm-hmm. And we see that, by the way, also in IT. If you want to have a green IT, you have a short, you know, a small footprint, you don't need too much energy, you conserve energy, you're sustainable and you are also productive. So we see a convergence of this focus on productivity and sustainability through technology.
Do you have a measure of how far companies have reached their targets who have integrated AI into their systems? Are they reaching those targets? Are they making headway?
What we do see, if we compare peers to peers across the globe, that companies that are embracing AI more broadly also actually have better financial results and also have better results from a sustainability point of view. So we really do see this congruence. However, we also need to see that a lot is still ahead. So if you ask CEOs around the world, as we did, we see that, you know, 75% of CEOs actually believe there is going to be massive competitive advantage for them if they use AI broadly. They basically say whoever uses the most AI is going to win.
Whoever maximizes it.
Absolutely. And if you look, however, how many companies and how many CEOs feel like they've really broadly not just started to integrate, but broadly started to use AI, it's much, much less.
But how exactly are they going to use AI for those goals? What do they get from
it? How do you operationalize?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's a good question. I think it comes back to the data, right? There is no AI strategy or great AI use case with actually a very sound data strategy behind it. So for sustainability goals, as well as for business goals, it's very important to use the data that companies have at hand. Sensor data out of manufacturing, for example, weather data, geospatial data, et cetera, et cetera. That allows them to create specific use cases to make them more productive and more sustainable eventually.
And when you have
those evidence-based decision making.
Right. Yeah. And I was going to ask that. You have that data, AI will be able to analyze it, but how do you convert that into actionable goals? Is it going to be up to the AI or part of the management already?
I think the goals need to be part of the strategy. And this is one thing that we also saw in the CEO study that we recently did, right? That there needs to be a strategic direction that needs to be set. And it's interesting who the CEOs actually lean to in terms of taking the strategic directions, decisions, and kind of business goal decisions. They actually look at those executives and those leaders in their organization who are very operational, very data-driven, and to some extent technical. So what we heard is COO, CFO, CIO are those that they turn to the most to actually, you know, not just set the goals, whether it's sustainability, whether it's innovation and technology adoption, but also execute those.
I can't even think of one company in the Philippines or in the world that is not, that does not rely on data now.
Yes. Everything. Making sense of the data, that's where the power of AI comes into.
Yeah. Even the sustainability reporting, for example, use case in government, which I suppose is one of your clients also, when there's a lot of sustainability reports, right? But how do you make sense of all those data? How do you create policy based on that data? Is that also something that IBM helps with?
Absolutely, and it also comes back to actually the accuracy and the quality of data. Because if we talk about AI, we also have to talk about the trustworthiness of AI, right? How can you actually be sure you don't have a bias in the model?
I heard it hallucinates.
It makes up things that sound perfectly great, right? And then at one point you realize, that was actually
it depends on what you feed it.
It's a 3D hallucination or a nightmare.
You're absolutely right, Ron. It depends on what you feed it. It's the data that is the basis for us. And we really believe from an IBM point of view in the AI models that we bring into the world, we need to know that the data is accurate, that it's actually compliant with regulatory requirements, that IP rights are clear. You know, companies and government agencies, they can't afford to take a gamble on that data quality, on that lineage of the data that
and
they use.
And that it's secure, of course. Yeah. AI and cybersecurity is another language.
Absolutely.
And sometimes companies now have to figure out how much do I really spend on cybersecurity to make sure that the data I've made sure is accurate and reliable is not hacked into by some other force outside of the universe from the next planet.
Exactly. Biggest concern by the CEOs that we talk to is really the security of the data. The second biggest concern is bias and accuracy of the outcome of an AI model. But cybersecurity at large is one of the biggest application field of AI that we see. And I mean, we are here in a region that's some of the most attacked regions globally, plus the impact from a breach goes up every year, right? So it's really a great use case to use AI and tackle, again, a quite difficult challenge besides sustainability, which is cyber attacks and cybersecurity.
And maybe, go ahead. No, your turn.
Okay, Agnes, I'd want to ask maybe for the business owners, the CEOs who are watching us, can you share a story maybe of a company successfully maximizing AI for their goals and objectives as well as their sustainability goals?
The companies that we have seen that are most successful actually make it a topic for everybody. It's not something that happens in isolation in an IT department or in tech department. They make sure that there is a skill building around AI and around data for everybody. And we often talk about ourselves as client zero. I mean, we have been using AI for a long time. You know, we also use it in sales, we use it in finance, we use it in HR. A lot of the HR services that we provide internally are done out of here in the Philippines, and AI is a big element there. In the past, managers had to kind of manage manually, you know, transfer one employee from one department to another or administer a pay rise. We do this all with AI now, and we will see more and more of the companies that are widely using it, that actually, you know, kind of motivate the business functions to co-create AI use cases, most successful ones.
Well, wait, can you visualize that for me? I ask a computer, can you figure out which is the best solution so that my teams work well together, and will it create for me sort of a this department should have these persons in it? That easy?
There's many very transactional things in HR, as I said, like, you know, increasing, you know, salary, for example. And yes, we have something that we call an Ask HR bot. So the manager goes in and says, I would like to kind of raise the salary of person X, Y, Z. How do I do it? The bot advises and automates.
Creates the charts.
Absolutely. We get, you know, alerts. Where do we have the biggest retention risks, you know, depending on the, you know, tenure and the skills and how the market develops and how actively those skills are kind of sought after, we get an alert that there might be a retention risk for this certain group of employees. So there's a lot of data and insight and also automation that can be actually done.
Very interesting. Can you give us more examples of solutions that you provide for the other departments, not just for HR?
IT is a very big one.
Of
so
course.
Code creation. I mean, we internally use Code Assistance, Watson Code Assistance, as we call it, but we also work with banks across the world to really make sure that a lot of coding, which is quite a tedious exercise sometimes, actually can be replaced with AI. And why not have those engineers do smart things?
AI to code for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know if I'm scared or happy about it.
I think if you ask the development community, there would be a lot of happiness there as well.
Just remember, automate the process, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Said, no, I have more broadband to think about the more serious stuff.
And more challenging questions at hand, yeah.
That's amazing. Sustainability is also a very big problem. Would you be able to help us understand how different or how does the Filipino CEO compare in thinking when it comes to AI and sustainability compared with the other CEOs in the areas that you're responsible for?
We saw already in the CEO study last year that in the Philippines, comparatively, it's a topic that's even higher on the agenda. It was high on the agenda globally, and it was high on the agenda in ASEAN, but the Philippines really just kind of topped this a little bit more. And also, just kind of from talking to a lot of organizations, a lot of companies here, it's striking. I mean, it's really a topic that does come up in every organization. So I don't think that this changed since last year. I still think it's high on the agenda. And I think it's good. It drives change. If it's not on the CEO's agenda, change won't happen.
Agnes, we're a country composed of more than 90% of micro, small, and medium enterprises. Maybe what advice can you give to those in that sector who may still be hesitating to integrate them into their systems? Should they jump in already? When some of them, of course, are still concerned about the losses they incurred during the pandemic. But is this the right time to jump in and maybe just start learning about it and maybe in the future integrate it into their systems?
I think you mentioned the absolute right point, which is start learning about it. I think we are entering a new era, or we have already entered a new era, and generative AI is going to change how we do business and how we work and how we, you know, live together as a society. So I think it doesn't matter if you're a big, you know, enterprise, big company, big organization, or a small and medium business, it will change the way you do business. And I think the key element is actually building and developing the skills that you need for it. We did a recent study specifically here in the Philippines to actually ask how does work change with AI and automation. And the executives we asked, they were very kind of, you know, clear that skills is what needs to be changed here in the Philippines and developed for AI specifically.
Maybe even to sustainability, because we're in the Pacific Ring of Fire and we
Absolutely.
Feel it tremendously, all of the flooding and all of the different kinds of weather disturbances. Even as we're talking about AI, we're also asking AI to help us save the planet.
Absolutely. In AI, we talk a lot about large language models and kind of creating pictures and texts and songs. I mean, we believe there's a big, you know, part that we need to talk about as well. We have geospatial models, for example, where we collaborate with NASA using all their data to maybe make more sense of what we can do about climate change and kind of, you know, predict a bit better how we react to it. So there's many, many things that can be done with AI, and I think that's one of the most important ones.
IBM has been working with AI 10 years ago,
more than
10 years ago. What will be in the future?
The rest of the world knew about ChatGPT.
Yeah, exactly.
Only November last year.
Exactly, but what are you seeing in the future? If you've worked this far ahead than a lot of other companies, what are you working on right now? Yeah. And what are you, where are you seeing AI?
Are you free to talk to us about that?
I know, I'm happy to talk about it.
You don't have to be giving specifics, but give us an idea.
Please give specifics.
The big thing that we do see down the road, and we already spend a lot of effort on, is quantum computing. And I think we will see specifically in the emergence of technologies like cloud, AI, and quantum computing together, we will be able to solve problems that we cannot solve with classical computing at the moment. I think there's still a couple of years out there, not a decade, less than a decade, right, that we predict until we will see that, you know, quantum computing is in effect and will already solve these problems that, you know, we at the moment can't even come up with enough computing power to solve.
I don't know if my brain can handle your definition of quantum computing, but please try.
Well,
how do you explain that?
Well, quantum computing basically uses a totally different kind of mindset around computing. Well, we had zeros and ones before, we now have quantum bits and we have states and entanglement, and it is quite complicated. But I think the kind of notion that is important for us to convey is it's not going to replace traditional computing. It's going to be hand in hand working with traditional computing as we know it. It's going to enhance it, and it's basically going to, you know, take, you know, batteries for e-vehicles. I mean, to find the best possible battery and create it and research for it, right, is a key element that actually needs quantum computing to really do a step change in kind of the quality that we see. We dream about actually capturing carbon oxide from the air, right, and kind of these kind of things is, you know, what we really dream of.
Those are great examples. Thank you very much. That didn't fly by my head. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Agnes, thank you very much. Thank you.